From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
So it's the Asamblea de Artistas Revolucionarios de Oaxaca. And they go by the acronym ASARO, and they sign as a collective, and this is partly as a way to, size of this. So this is partly as a way to be in solidarity together, but it's also a safety measure because this group began during the teacher uprisings in 2006. I'm going to lay it down. It's a little difficult to.
Yeah, you want to crumble it up.
But they're very fresh. So these began during the uprisings in 2006, and the artists sign as a collective, partly as a safety measure to keep some individual anonymity.
Oh, that's right.
But the images are very powerful. They were meant to be shown on the streets. They were meant to bring attention to any number of different issues that were important to the artists. So artists' responses to an array of different social and political subjects.
And then, so you're right, this takes place in Oaxaca. And just like in the other examples, these are artists that are saying something to the public at large. Oaxaca has a lot of art recently that's been coming out.
Absolutely.
And I just met some artists in a great group of artists, the Oaxaca, Oaxaqueños, in Seattle. And there's a great group of artists in Seattle. And here we see doing a similar kind of work, but this is very different. And I'm so glad to hear this. And we're going to also perhaps feature some of this work by ASARO. Asamblea?
Asamblea de Artistas Revolucionarios de Oaxaca. Well, so thankfully, they're called very concisely by ASARO.
ASARO.
Can we talk a little bit about the imagery here?
Sure, let's talk about
it. It's really interesting in terms of sort of visual literacy because it's a very poetic image. It's not a literal image.
That's right.
And you sort of have to spend time with it and read it just the way you would read a poem or a book.
That's true. So there's kind of like a tendedero, a clothesline, mm-hmm. or it could be a rail, or it could be a rainbow.
I thought papel picado.
Oh, papel picado. Papel picado. Right. And there's eyes, and there's a woman's face looking down, and she's very sad, serious, mm-hmm. troubled, solemn, in pain, perhaps. And then there's three more papeles. Hanging and flowing in the wind or rain, and they are images of?
Angels. Three angels.
And there's two hands shooting out of the earth or the darkness, and they are, what are they doing?
It looks very, it's a ambivalent image to me because they look very vital and they're reaching to the sky, but the figure is essentially buried. And
it's
so
buried.
You have all of these clues that lead you to the idea that this is maybe a memorial or a mourning image.
Yeah.
Although it's not titled, it's not dated, but we know it's from around 2006 to 2009, so we know when and where it was made and by whom, and we have these clues, but you can interpret it different ways.
That's right. And even the buried figure remains vital.
And the cacti and the mountains and the rain also shooting stars, you know, so lots of different.
And the artwork is also vibrating.
Absolutely. It's really robust, this carving. And then a very classical image. I mean, we have images by Elizabeth Catlett that are celebrating the laborer, the worker, the farmer, and the title here. They've given us some text. You see very prominent front and center, Dignidad.
Dignidad.
Dignity.
Dignity.
And then smaller.
And smaller hidden figures, which say lucha.
Yeah.
Struggle, fight. And what are those? Is it corn?
Maíz.
Maíz kind of has a sense of being a grenade, but
it's true. They almost look like so. It's a power image. They almost look like weapons.
Like weapons.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah,
But every person can come to these images and sort of get something different from them. We know a little bit about, we know a lot about the artist's intent, but I love that almost everything here, these are, sometimes they have documentary elements or responding to specific events in history and time, but they're poetic images. They're artists' responses.
They're poetic images, and they're beautiful, and they're not, they take time to create, and yet they're looking out. They want to tell us something. They're not necessarily for a private. Who knows? Let's leave it open. Are they private? Are they public? Are they both? And
these were meant to be in the street. These
meant
were
meant
to be.
They're meant to be in the streets, and now they're meant to be out in the streets again, throughout the United States.
It belongs to every. I mean, we've been giving you wonderful red carpet treatment, but this treatment is available to anyone who comes here as a researcher. This collection belongs to everyone. It belongs to you. It belongs to you. It belongs to everyone.
Beautiful, yeah. Beautiful, beautiful. And
you've been creating new artwork and new poetry on the spot right here, automatic drawing.
Yes, I have.
Responding.
Yes, I have. This one is called Give Power. And
that was a generous.
As a matter of fact, that was your line. Was that your line?
You asked me to title it, and of course I'm with the Poet Laureate of the United States, and I got nervous and I didn't want to provide a title, and I said, you're giving me a lot of power, and so you're like, that's what we're going to call it.
That's right.
Empowerment.
That's right. We're not going to wait for to write. We never wait to write. Always write right there at the moment. You wait to write, something's going to happen. As a matter of fact, right before you write, that's the idea. So this is called Give Power. And since today is an anniversary,
yes,
of 9/11,
that's right.
So it's like a drawing poem, and this is Give Power, and it's dedicated for, and then there's a heart and a circle. So I'm going to leave that with you. Perhaps it's dedicated to love and to unity. And it has images like this. So page 1 and 2 is La Luna, La Vida, and the last page is La Estrella, the moon, life, and the star.
And these are recurring motifs for you. This is something that you carry with you, I think.
I think you got me on that.
I think.
And then there's kind of a light gray marker with a moon and kind of like a sea anemone. And an energy ring, and some waves, and some Maya numbers. And we made a book out of it.
Yeah.
Made a book out of
on
it.
On the spot.
On the spot.
You did it today.
Did it today.
Very, very quickly and directly from your conscious and subconscious and
well,
emotion.
What else could it be?
It's wonderful. So and also poetry.
And we did some poems, too. And I'm just going to just show them to you. Here's a poem. It's called Non-Toxic Screen Method. And here's another one. It's called Little Shoes on the Corner. And this has to do with the prayer rug.
Right.
This has to do with the prayer rug.
Right.
And
the Helen's You Gave drawing.
Yes. Little Shoes on the Corner, Tapete, Carpet. Are you waiting? Fly with rebirth prayer for us. All come together, but how? Two cultures, banner, American, Arab. How the buildings come back up as we stand, color to color, America's Middle East, together. Non-toxic screen method. So you can do this anytime. And what else do we have?
Let's walk around the corner to Julia de Burgos, who's one of the heroes in your recent book.
Yeah, we're going to walk around the corner and to Julia de Burgos, a Puerto Rican poet, an amazing activist, woman of her time. And we also have it in like a multicolor format
Antonio Martorell from Puerto Rico and printed in Ponce.
Antonio Martorell.
Brand new acquisition, 2014.
2014.
It's from 2014, and it's again a combination of digital and traditional woodcut printmaking.
Digital and traditional, and then we have a lot of material that we've been just bringing out, and it's all available here. We have Artemio Rodriguez, with Loteria.
The Loteria series, which relates to your book of Loteria poems.
That's right. And that's Artemio Rodriguez. And then we have Yolanda Lopez. And she's talking about farm worker women and...
Women's work is never done.
Women's work is never done with Dolores Huerta.
Another hero.
Another hero. And then we have something very magical. A Russian...
Leonid Tishkov from Moscow. And he, this is from a series that he conceives of as a visual poem. It's called his Private Moon series. And you really...
I like
sort
that.
Of went deep into these images.
I like that a lot because it's so dreamlike and it's not, you know, a direct message, a piece. It's something that you meditate on and it's eerie and it's magical and it's luminous and it's multi-layered and with little poems written on the side. Little poems written on the side of a beautiful print and all this material is just so inspiring. And then we have this particular artist that you mentioned to me.
Robert Blackburn.
Robert Blackburn, another amazing silkscreen artist.
He is a lithographer, color lithography, and that's what this is. This is called Girl in Red, and it's from 1950. And one of the wonderful things is that it was on exhibit at the Library of Congress in our 1897 historic Jefferson Building.
Oh.
We had national exhibitions of prints for many years, and this work was hanging at the Library of Congress when it was fresh off the press in 1950.
So see, that's beautiful. Yeah. I'm really inspired by that piece. Beautiful.
Well, he was another person. This Casa de Colores idea was something that he also took to heart. He grew up during he grew up in the WPA Harlem Art Center, where he learned lithography first as a very young, talented artist. And then he worked at a master printer at a legendary printmaking studio called ULAE with Rauschenberg, Jasper Johns, Frankenthaler.
That's amazing.
And he, in the late 1940s, he made his own studio, which was open. And his concept was that it was open to artists of all stripes and also of different levels of ability. So you have master artists working with artists who are coming to printmaking for the first time. So it was his own Casa de Colores. The printmaking workshop in New York was, you would have loved it. You would still love it. It still exists.
I still love it. And I'm so glad you told me all about him. And we also have, is it Juan Fuentes? Juan Fuentes Cesar Chavez. Amazing print. And then we have Estela Hernandez and her Lidia Mendoza.
You ask for music. Tejana music specifically, yeah?
Tejana music pioneer from the 1920s, Lidia Mendoza, that just kept on going and created so much great root music or source music for the rest of us that came along with guitars and especially women songwriters and all the musical heritage that we have for Latinas and Latinos, and of course, the public at large in the United States and our a truly American culture. Beautiful print by Esther Hernandez, and it's also here, and it's beautiful, radiant colors.
You're making a really wonderful point, which is that all of these connect to all of the different artistic languages, so you can go and listen to original music, you can go and listen to poetry readings by poets across time. You know, it goes on and on, the sort of connections and layers. And thank you for bringing your artist's eye and your poet's voice to these materials.
Thank you. Thank you, Catherine. This is really beautiful. I want to thank you for inviting me over.
It's an honor and a pleasure.
Thank you, and for bringing out these beautiful materials. A family of great artists for the people.
Yes.
And Casa de Colores and El Jardín. We're going to work on something to feature from this beautiful collection for everyone to see online pretty soon.
Our seeds and flowers and plants.
Seeds and flowers and plants and prints and photographs. How's that?
Perfect.
Yeah?
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.